Mama don't allow no architecture around here. Mama don't allow no architecture around here. Oh, I don't care what mama don't allow, gonna draw mine modern anyhow. Mama don't allow no architecture around here.
Welcome to U.S. Modernist Radio, where we talk and laugh with people who enjoy, own, create, dream about, preserve, love, and hate modernist architecture, the most exciting and controversial buildings in the world. Show your support by visiting U.S. Modernist Massive Mid-Century Modern Archives at usmodernist.org or leave a positive review on iTunes. Today, author Sam Lubell tells us where to plan our next modernist pilgrimage. And now, the guys voted most likely to eat Twix the wrong way, George Smart and Tom Guild.
Hi, folks. I'm Tom Guild, and we are planning future podcast guests for late 2018 and early 2019 already. And if there's someone in the wonderful world of modernist architecture that you'd like to suggest as a guest, email George, not me, George, at usmodernist.org. Now, support for U.S. Modernist Radio comes from realtor Angela Roll. In a story that's almost completely alternative facts, modernist design expert Angela Roll was out of money on the streets of Paris with only six friends to help. Ada, a computer expert. Maybelline, an expert at disguises. Shannon, an acrobat and former CIA agent. Baby G, a DJ with a mysterious past. And her Aunt Betty, who made lunch. Angela masterminded a midnight heist from a 747 at Charles de Gaulle Airport, stealing a rare limited edition Ferrari from her arch enemy, Jean Nouvel. Days later, driving it through the streets of Monte Carlo, she was spotted by Detective Eric of Toulouse. Sounded just like that. Eric was able to distract Angela with original Neutra renderings while impounding the Ferrari. As she was just about to steal it back, he proposed, and they wed the day before the Grand Prix. Now living in America, today Angela uses her architectural training and quick thinking to specialize in modernist houses, advising buyers and sellers on everything from appropriate renovation to finding the best coffee. Angela Roll is your special agent. Reach her at angelaroll.com. That's R-O-E-H-L or 919-995-0550. And by the way, the Ferrari was returned.
Thank you, Tom. I'm George Smart. Our guest Sam Lubell was born in France and grew up in the United States. He writes for Wired, the Architect's Newspaper, the New York Times, the Los Angeles Times. These are all small publications, Sam. Los Angeles Magazine, Architect, Architectural Record, and Architectural Review, among many others. Recently, he co-curated exhibitions, Never Built Los Angeles, and Shelter, Rethinking How We Live in Los Angeles. He has written seven books, maybe eight by now, about architecture, including one of my favorites, The Mid-Century Modern Architectural Travel Guide West Coast USA, with its companion piece, East Coast USA, coming out this fall. Welcome, Sam.
Good to be here. Thanks for having me.
Oh, you bet. I met Sam, what was it, a year ago we had breakfast?
Something like that.
Something like
that.
Yeah,
that was fun.
And found out about all you're doing. You're just everywhere. I mean, how do you find the time?
Oh, well, I guess when you're enjoying what you're doing, is that you can always find time to do it. And, a lot of good stuff. Very interesting.
So let's start at the beginning. You were born in France. Where about?
I was born just outside of Paris in Boulogne, which I guess it's an upscale suburb of Paris, I guess.
Okay. And did you grow up in France?
I did not. I only lived there until I was 2 years old. So I barely learned to speak, baby garble in French. And I grew up in Philadelphia, or just outside of Philadelphia. Although I did go back to France, go back to Paris to study abroad. So and I worked on a couple projects there. So I definitely have a connection there.
Did you have a hard time learning the language in Philadelphia?
It was tougher than being in Paris. Yeah, that's true.
Well, it's a city of brotherly love and liberté, égalité, fraternité, it all goes together, right?
No, it's true. Very connected revolutions, whatnot, in my opinion, connected cities, although I wouldn't ever call Philadelphia the Paris of much of anything.
Now, in Philadelphia, there are cheesesteaks. But I understand that the best cheesesteak is actually not in Pennsylvania. It's across the river in Camden somewhere.
In New Jersey?
Yeah, in New Jersey.
Ooh, man.
Really?
You just
yeah.
got a
I've
whole
been,
state
I've been reading
you.
About this. I'll have to Google the name here in a moment. But that's on my bucket list for places to go visit.
I did not know that, actually. So if that's true, I have to try it because I've tried
it. It's some legendary, I think it's called Donkey something, but it's over the river in Camden. We'll get to that in a minute.
Okay. I'll have to put that in the next travel guide.
Sam, how did you get into architecture and particularly into writing about it so prolifically?
It's funny. I just saw the person that really got me into architecture because I was at my, I won't say the number, but I was at a reunion for my college. I went to Brown and the professor was named Dietrich Neumann. And I took his class on 20th century architecture. And then my whole trajectory sort of shifted towards wanting to study architecture or architectural history. So that was the first step. And then the second step was after I'd been a journalist for a few years, going to a freelancer's sort of lecture, I guess it was a panel, and running into one of the editors at Architectural Record. Her name is Deb Smunian. She's now in L.A. And she talked me into doing a couple stories. And then from there, I became the news editor at Architectural Record. This was back in 2003. And then I've been working on architecture ever since.
You wrote two great books. I mean, these two books you have on Mid-Century Modern Travel Guide. I don't know if I could, in a lifetime, go to all those places. I mean, how did you research this? There are just hundreds and hundreds of them.
Yeah, it's a lot of work, but it's a lot of fun. And I have a great partner, the photographer Darren Bradley, who you know, I believe, right?
Sure. Yeah.
Yeah. He's also a savant in modern architecture, so it's a good combination. And for me, it's getting to basically go back to school and learn about all the buildings of all the architects I already knew, and then getting to visit them. And it's an excuse to visit places that I never would have had the time to do. So all those places, you kind of on your list that you can't get around to seeing, you get to do and get paid for it. So it's a good deal.
Tell us about some of your favorite places you visited working on the books, both East Coast and West Coast.
Oh, boy. I mean, there's so many. I think what we tried to do was visit a lot of the kind of standard, sort of like the Stahl House in L.A., of course, and on the East Coast, like the Seagram Building and the Gropius House, but then mix that with a lot of surprises. And there's so many. There's so many just outstanding surprises that we just kind of really dug. And, you find out who the architects, the big architects were. And you also find out who some of the lesser known architects were in each of these places that you go all the way down each coast. And between that, you've got an incredible mix. So of the giants of architecture, I can't stress enough going to the Kahn Exeter Library. Louis Kahn's Exeter Library for the first time was one of these awe-inspiring experiences. Just his ability to just kind of lift your spirit and sort of take your breath away. There are very few places that have done that the way that did that on the East Coast. And there's just so many more. And I, on the West Coast, one of the surprises, although I knew about it, but was Frank Lloyd Wright's son, Lloyd Wright, his Wayfarers Chapel. And just the way that's in Palos Verdes, and the way that it blends with the landscape, it's basically, redwood columns, and it just blends in with the redwood forest. You can't tell where the beams begin and where the forest ends, and it's right on the coast. And, places like that are just magic. And if you haven't been before, you realize why, it's important to go, not just to kind of learn about or read about these places.
Lloyd Wright was one of those architects that was overshadowed by his famous father. He doesn't get some of the credit he really deserves.
Oh, yeah, to say the least. I mean, he was bitter about that his whole life, to be honest, about being overshadowed by Frank Lloyd Wright. And I've always wondered if Frank Lloyd Wright named his son Lloyd so that possibly people confused the names. Who knows? He wasn't the most supportive father in his son's career. But Lloyd Wright just has an endless amount of fantastic projects. He had an office right on Doheny and in West Hollywood. And just his collection of buildings is absolutely phenomenal.
Lloyd Wright also catered to a number of the celebrities at that time. A lot of silent screen stars.
Yep, he hung out with all these stars. He designed houses for a lot of them and for a lot of directors. I think one of his houses had a famous Hollywood murder involving the Black Dahlia. He had an eye for theatricality. I think my favorite is the Samuel Navarro House, which is in the Hollywood Hills. And you kind of come around the corner and it just... absolutely, it looks like something out of, should be in a movie set. It doesn't look like it's real, with these sort of copper, patinated copper flashing all over the place and sort of makes its way down the hillside. It looks like something that, you know, definitely probably the bad guy in a movie, but, you know, could be the good guy. But it certainly looks theatrical, and everything he did was like that.
Is that where the murder took place?
No, the murder took place in a different house. It was in Los Feliz, and
It was in the Leimert Park neighborhood.
Oh, Snowden. It's the Snowden house.
Snowden house. S-O-W-D-N. Yeah.
That's a great place to be.
And the Black Dahlia was a person, right?
Yeah, and it's a pretty, there's a whole movie about it, one of the more gruesome stories in the Hollywood history. I want to know more about it, but I know that mostly because I'm an architecture person, is what I know is this connection to architecture more than the story itself, which tells you a lot about, you know, how I approach things.
Your priorities.
Yeah, it's usually about architecture.
Now, this just in, our cheesesteak location is called Donkey's Place.
Okay.
It's at 1223 Haddon Avenue, Camden, New Jersey, 08103.
Wow. It's not a Wawa.
It has been around for 75 years.
Oh, man.
And people just go crazy over the cheesesteaks there. So I'm going to see about jumping up there sometime, maybe this summer.
I can't say that I've had many reasons to go to Camden, and now I have one.
And now you have one.
That's a big deal. I'm going to check it out.
When you were going around looking at all these houses, Sam, I noticed that in the directory, a number of them are not open to the public. Did you get inside some just as a journalist or writer that the public wouldn't be able to access?
Yeah, we had to make a choice about that. And the decision we made was that we wanted to include as many houses that people could see as possible. But the limit was houses that you could not see from the street were off the list. Which knocked out a lot of houses that you can't even see at all, because modernism, especially a lot of, you know, glass modernism, it's all about being close to the public so that you can open up to the elements. So then you have high walls and also, you know, places in Beverly Hills, for instance, you have high walls because a lot of famous people are living in them, and those are off the table. But yeah, we did allow places that were you could see from the street, and we emphasize in the book not to bother the residents and not to go on the property, but that's fair game to see it from the street.
I guess that's why it's a good idea to have a good photographer on your side.
Yes, Darren is a master. He is definitely a master.
When you and Darren were walking around, did you get invited in anybody's house?
Oh, yeah, all the time. All the time. We got into houses. that's my assistant, Trooper. he agrees about going into houses is a good thing. basically, our percentage, if the owner was around, and we would try to go and ring on their doorbell if we couldn't reach them ahead of time, because we were looking at, you know, 10 to 20 houses a day. You can't give everybody a heads up. Pretty much all the time, if you ring on the doorbell, they would answer and let us in and talk to us. We're excited because they're excited about having these houses. There is the occasional person that's not, and they maintain their privacy, or for whatever reason they don't want it. But generally, you know, if you knock on somebody's door, they'll want to talk to you. And that was one of the most fun parts of the project, is getting to meet these people that live in the house and talk to them and hear their stories. And I can't tell you how many of those we saw.
Well, what were some of the interesting stories you heard?
I mean, there's just so many. One of the great ones that just comes to mind was a house in up in Big Sur, or near Big Sur. I guess it's closer to Monterey. And the house is owned by a woman who's now, she's in her late 90s. And she, the house is one of those houses that we just sort of discovered by accident, actually. But it's just an absolutely incredible house. And she was, just talked to, she's like sat me down on her, in her living room and talked to me about her husband who designed it, and her work with designer, I should say, and, you know, gave me tea and you just talked about the stories, and that's not a rare thing. I mean, people would let me in to houses. I was in a house far from Santa Barbara that the owner, you know, at first they'll sort of be a little bit suspicious, but then they come in, and you come in, and then they're really excited to talk to you. Just for everywhere you go, they just want to tell you about the stories and tell you about how the challenge of building these things, how much they appreciate it. you know, if they were suspicious at first because they didn't know about modern architecture, by the end, they almost to a T, they just loved it. They loved being surrounded by the elements. They loved the open plans. And it was really kind of, it kind of reinforced just how effective most of these houses, or basically all of these houses, are for people.
Did you get any good stories about the architects themselves that designed them?
Yeah, we did. I'm trying to think. I was talking to, there was a, one of the case study houses that I didn't know much about, case study number 10. It's in Pasadena. And kind of, you know, discovering all these houses, but this was by an architect named Kemper Nomland, who I didn't know about at all before this. And we talked to the owners, and the owners kind of, you know, the house had been sort of fallen on hard times, and they kind of got to know the architect and what he had done. And then they just almost rebuilt it from scratch. And they kind of, it became a complete passion of theirs. Their names are Tim Morris and Diane Kawashima. And they just fell in love with this house and this architect that nobody had ever heard of. They just sort of became obsessed with. And there's a similar story in Pasadena, right down the street, not too far from there, this Buff and Hensman house. And the owners, we just knocked on the door, and they just couldn't stop talking about how much they loved the house. And they had hired an architect to redo it and recover it into its greatness. And just the stories you get from these owners would just, they did all the research for me in that case, because they learned all about the house. They learned about the architects. They learned about, you know, what makes the house special. Because, you know, some of these houses are over half a century old. They basically all need some
or more. Yes, sure. Was there something in common amongst all these owners that struck you in any way? Obviously, they love their houses.
They do love their houses. I think often they know what they're getting, even if they didn't at first. Once they start to discover it, they start to realize that these things are a really big deal, and they appreciate that, and they appreciate being in an architectural house. I think most homeowners don't care who did their house or what it's about. But these owners do care. And I think, you know, that's what makes great architecture. Also is what makes great kind of renovations of architecture. If somebody cares about the story, and they all kind of do, they just get it. And when they don't, that's when you have houses, which happens quite a bit too, that get destroyed or get renovated. You know, they get brought up to a completely different state, which is sad. And they, you know, they don't understand it, but when they do, that's what makes a good house. And it's the same thing as the client when the house is beginning. You know, what really makes a difference is the client. And that's the case in that respect as well. By the way, I should mention that clamshell house that was by Carmel and Monterey.
Yeah.
Because I had forgotten the name of the architect. I just remembered. The architect's Mark Mills, who is a fantastic architect.
Oh, sure.
And did so many incredible. And the owner is Janice O'Brien. There's just so many houses, sometimes I forget. and Mid-Century West has been a few years now, so this is fun. I'm remembering things slowly.
Did you run across any houses that were in real danger that needed to be saved?
Yes, and that's always scary and sad. And sometimes you just see fences around them and they're done. And that happens, you know, sometimes. And then there's one in particular that really was disturbing, which was Paul Rudolph's Milam residence. Outside Jacksonville Beach.
Oh, yes.
One of the best, you know, houses, one of the most impactful houses in modern architectural history. When we got there, I mean, this was a few months after one of the major hurricanes last summer, I guess. And when we got there, basically it's built on a dune that, you know, the landscape goes way out towards the ocean. When we were there, that landscape was gone. It had been completely ripped away, and the house was kind of leaning over the edge. And, in really bad shape, and we're scared that it might not make it. And I actually talked to the Paul Rudolph Foundation, and they're trying to work on saving it. But nobody, they didn't know, and nobody knew that it was in that case. It was for sale, and that was the last people had heard, was that, you know, it was up for sale and hopefully it would be saved. But we didn't know that it was in that bad shape until we went and saw it. And, you know, it's scary because you know these houses pretty well once you've researched them, and also just because it's part of architectural history. And to see them in such difficult shape is disturbing, or to see them replaced by McMansion, you know, very disturbing. And it's part of the territory.
The last I heard, which is about 5 months ago, I talked to the real estate agent who's listing the property, and they've repaired most of that damage on the back where mm-hmm. a lot of the decks
That's
were
good.
Knocked away and are restoring
That's good.
It.
Good to hear.
The lady who lives in there is getting on in years, and her son lives across the street.
And so they're selling the house because the lady is going to be moving out into a retirement gotcha. Home, I presume. And it is a difficult sell. I mean, even though it's an iconic structure, this layout is not for everybody. It's one of the dilemmas that people have.
Yeah, that's true. And some of the houses can be changed and updated for modern lifestyle. Some of them can't, depending on if they're landmarked or not. And that's always a dilemma. Do you update this for new bathrooms, new kitchens? Do you keep it as is, as a historical record? But yeah, that's always a difficult thing. And with something like the Milam, you have to deal with things like, you know, is this under threat in the future? That was certainly an issue with the Ennis house, Frank Lloyd Wright's house in Los Angeles. It was on the market for a long, long time because nobody wanted, you know, it's one thing to buy the house, but it's a house that's got retaining walls that, you know, hold it up. And, you know, and they were in trouble. It was going to several million and, you know, up to 10 million.
Lots of leaks, yes.
In fixing up the house and its leaks, but also just keeping it from falling down the hillside. So you know, these things are some major, some of them are major investments. And I respect people that really want to do that because it's more than just about architecture. It's about maintaining the historical legacy. And of course, when you do it, it's not a bad investment because modern houses are only, you know, the people are only more and more starting to realize the value of these amazing houses.
So what happened to the Ennis house? Do you remember? Who did somebody buy it?
The Ennis house, yeah. It was the guy used to hang out with Bill Clinton on the airplanes. And
Ron Burkle.
What's his name? Ron Burkle. Ron Burkle bought it about 2011. And he's the one doing the restoration. He's a big architecture fan. And he has an agreement in the lease that he has to show it to the public. I think it's about once a year, not a lot, but it's still not, you know, it's not a museum, but it's not completely closed to the public. And he's not going to change the house. So that's a, you know, with that kind of money, he can do that kind of thing. And that's a good client as long as he respects the architecture.
He bought the Bob Hope house, too, in Palm Springs, I believe.
I think you're right. I mean, there's definitely some of these very wealthy patrons that are sort of collecting architecture. I think it's a good thing as long as they respect the architecture. It's not a bad thing at all.
One of our recent guests was Michael Lefetre, who is a serial modernist. He's owned maybe a dozen modernist houses over time and has bought them and fixed them up very faithfully, restored them, and then sold them to new owners and has really given them great life.
Yeah, he's a great example. He's a great, great example. And we need more of those people that get it, people that have the funds to do it. There's, we were in Sarasota. Sarasota was all about having, when it first started out, when it was getting built, Hisp, you know, he was a millionaire who really understood architecture and, you know, developed Lido Shores and, you know, he was already didn't happen. And now you have the same thing happening again with restoring and owning these buildings. You have these really wealthy patrons that own a lot of these houses. The owners of the Umbrella House, Paul Rudolph's Umbrella House, they own a few of the houses. They also own his Harkavy House. They own that. They own, you know, a lot of people don't just own one of these houses, and it's not a bad thing necessarily. Unless there are occasions when these houses just become sort of trophy houses and nobody actually lives in them, and that's not ideal. It's nice to have people living in them, but if they're keeping them in good shape and people can visit them and see them and understand the legacy, that, you know, I'm for it.
Well, let's shift gears a little bit. In 2013, you wrote a fascinating book called Never Built Los Angeles. Tell us about that.
Yeah. Wow. That was back in 2013.
so long ago.
Thinking about how many years it's been since college, how many years since Never Built. Never Built Los Angeles was actually the idea didn't come from me or my co-author, Greg Golden. It came from the director of the A+D Architecture and Design Museum at the time, Tibby Dunbar. And she wanted us to work on a project looking at, you know, just a few pieces of architecture in L.A. that didn't happen. She got the idea when she visited the Getty Research Institute Models Archive, and she kind of was inspired by a few of the Never Built projects. And we sort of changed that from just a few projects to over 100. And it wasn't just architecture. It was also planning and parks and highways, just the whole city as it would have been. And from there came Never Built Los Angeles, which became a book and an exhibit in 2013. And then from there, we have a new book and exhibit, Never Built New York. And the exhibit was last fall at the Queens Museum. And the book came out a year prior to that. And I mean, it's just a fascinating look at what could have been. People love to, you know, kind of look at the alternate history, both in their own lives and in the life of a city. And you start to realize how extraordinarily different cities could have been. LA could have had an emerald necklace of parks. It could have had an incredibly vital system of subways back, you know, in the 20s, not in the 80s when it finally got around to building them. They could have had freeways going off the shore of Santa Monica, which is not a good example. And similarly for New York, you know, these things that could have happened and really fundamentally changed a city. So it's a fun project to work on and a great way to kind of understand that architects do so much more than ever gets seen by most people. It's just that's part of, that goes with the territory of being an architect or an urban designer or anybody building things.
Well, the projects that you chronicled in both the Los Angeles and New York books, were they back of the envelope sketches or ideas, or how far along did they get before someone said no?
Well, there's no rule to this, but we generally tried to look at things that weren't just napkin sketches that were pretty far along and that were pretty close to happening. There are some exceptions, but even those as conceptual plans were fairly far along, you know, like plans by Buckminster Fuller to build a dome over Manhattan, or, you know, sort of very conceptual ideas, but they're important enough that we wanted to share them. But generally, we have ideas that, you know, they were in some sort of design documents or even construction documents, and they were on the boards and they had a client. And that tells you a lot about the city when you get to that stage and you find out why things didn't happen. You find out less, you know, why something on a napkin didn't happen. That was an important part of our criteria.
Well, what are some of the exciting projects in New York, for example, that didn't get built?
Besides the dome?
Well, there's exciting, there's terrifying.
Okay, we'll take that too.
And there's a little bit of, there's some that combine both. Here's one that combines both. IMPEI wanted to do a plan called the Hyperboloid, this sort of hyperbolic sort of hourglass structure that would have risen, you know, taller than the Empire State Building. I'd say about 30 to 40 years ahead of its time as far as design goes. This amazing exoskeleton design that you sort of see towers emulating now. It was built in the 50s, or was going to be built in the 50s. So that's the exciting part. And then the less exciting part is that it would have replaced Grand Central Station, and that was the idea. And it was a legitimate plan by the developer, William Zeckendorf, who was Pei's chief, was his boss for the first 7 or 8 years of his career. He hired him. And, you know, there's several more like that. So that's an example of how some things are, you know, things that we would have loved and hated at the same time.
And how about in Los Angeles?
Oh, well, in L.A., there's just so many. But back to Frank Lloyd Wright, you know, there's just, it's unending. But if you, I don't know if you know Runyon Canyon, but he was, he wanted to build what was called the Huntington-Hartford Sports Park, or I guess it was basically a country club on the top of Runyon Canyon. And it was these saucer-shaped, interconnected forms, literally hovering over the canyon. And just as far as dramatic and sort of adventurous schemes, there's sort of these amazing cantilevers and these dome shapes, sort of like flying saucers. Just an incredible design. And his son, Lloyd, again, who we mentioned, had a whole plan for the Civic Center of L.A. that would have absolutely, utterly transformed downtown L.A. into sort of this complex, almost like a Mayan or Aztec temple complex. Sort of in that Hollywood vein that we're talking about. But these are things that would have, if they had been built, you know, the LA as we know it or the New York as we know it would be just completely, completely different.
I know Elon Musk right now, famous for Tesla and rockets and everything else, is planning a Hyperloop underground train from LAX north underneath the mountain into the valley. I don't know how far along that's going to be coming, but I'm wondering if that's going to be a never built LA project in
Is that going to go to San Francisco all the way?
There's a different one that's going to go to San Francisco. This one is just a sort of short demonstration line that goes, what, 10 miles, 15 miles into the valley?
Yeah. Well, you know, that's the demonstration line, and that's probably going to get built. Whether the one that goes all the way to San Francisco happens, you know, that's a big if. And that's an interesting trend with never built is, like it or not, with Elon Musk, that's ambition right there. And that, you know, it's often the line is when things are too ambitious or too far ahead of their time. That's often when they don't happen. And it's funny that there's a very similar project in New York in the 1870s by a guy named Alfred Eli Beach. He wanted to do the Beach Pneumatic Railway. And he actually built a test couple blocks of it underneath Broadway between about Murray and Warren Street right next to City Hall. So he had a test run, but that one was never built. But it's almost the exact same strategy, which is you're using pressurized air very different propellant system. He was using steam engines, and Musk is not. But you see these things repeat themselves like that over and over, and it's kind of incredible to see. You know, that's 1870, Elon Musk was now, let's say, 2018, so give or take 150 years, these ideas can keep coming back. And the reasons they don't happen are always the same, too. It's always money, it's always politics, it's always conflicts between a client and architect, or, you know, between client and other client. You know, these ideas never stop.
Yeah, I was watching TV the other night late, and there was this movie from the late 60s called, maybe early 70s, called Genesis 2 by Gene Roddenberry, the guy that did Star Trek. And it starred Alex Cord, who went on to very minor fame as the boss of the guy in Airwolf. Anyway, the whole
that's a big role.
Yeah. The whole theme of Genesis 2, the background was these series of underground pneumatic tubes, which crossed the country. So it was at least in science fiction, the movies in the 60s.
And department stores in the 60s.
Oh, yeah. Department stores had those little tiny things that shot the charge slips from one floor to the other.
I never knew what was in there.
Yeah. And I remember going to the bank teller, you know, with my mom when I was a kid, and they had those pneumatic tubes there. And
they still have those at a lot of drive-through banks.
Yeah. And London actually built like a whole network of those at some point. And it was sort of, that was what Beach was modeling this whole thing after. Was he had originally gotten the okay to do the pneumatic tubes as a system of sending packages. And he sort of secretly did a whole transit system, or at least a few blocks of the transit system. You know, it wasn't known to the authorities. But then they saw it and they actually kind of liked it. So a bill went forward called the Beach Pneumatic Bill. That thing was killed because, again, politics, and Tammany Hall killed it, basically. They were friends with the governor, who then vetoed it. So, you know, again, these things happen. But, yeah, these ideas keep coming. And certainly in, you know, mid-century, in the future of Seth's time, the pneumatic tube was sort of this kind of incredible technological symbol of the future. And you look at sci-fi, you look at, you know, all these things kind of come together. It's really interesting.
Well, you know, we have magnetically levitated trains. The Shanghai train from downtown to the airport is a maglev. I think there are a couple of other ones around the world, not huge distances. I wonder if anybody ever did a pneumatic train fully scaled and got it working.
Not that I know of. Maglev's the closest that I know of. There's certainly bullet trains, so that's not the same thing. But I think Musk is the first one to really get a lot of, since some of these earlier plans, I think in London I heard that they actually did have some pneumatic trains in London that were going. I've never actually seen any sort of evidence of that, but there was in the pneumatic writing that we read, the writing about the Beach pneumatic, he had mentioned that London had gotten a couple of these things up and running. So I'd like to see that. I think, you know, someday maybe we do Neverville, London, and I'll find out more. But
I bet that could be a very big book.
Yeah.
The city like London.
The next book we're doing is Neverbuilt Paris, which is an equally big one.
Awesome.
So you find some stuff. I mean, these things, you know, the imagination has no limits. And if you go back far enough in history, you'll find these things coming back again and again. And it's incredible.
Well, in anticipation of your new book on Paris, I want to talk about one of your old books on Paris. This is going to take you way back, Sam, all the way to 2007. You wrote a book called Paris 2000 Plus about the new buildings that had come up in that city. Tell us about some of the great architecture that you can find in Paris, some of the new stuff.
Oh, yeah. You're really going back there. This is good. Now I have to comb my brain pretty well.
We can find a blow dryer or something around here. We can shoot you up with it.
I mean, Paris is, and I'm looking forward to going back to start doing the research for Neverville Paris. But I think what you get from looking at Neverville Paris and from Paris 2000 Plus is that Paris has this strain of incredible experiment that people don't really realize. I think people just think of the Louvre and they think of the classical architecture. But when French architects or architects working in Paris can do it, they do some really, you know, wild stuff. Really
like
wild
the metro,
stuff.
The subway is very. It's art.
It is.
And they're signage and everything.
Some of the best architects in the world are doing the next extension of the subway. And we have, in 2000 plus, we had some, you know, a firm called Art Charpentier did some incredible glass dome over one of the subways near the Gare Saint-Lazare. But we have some of the younger architects in Paris. There's an architect named Manuel Gautran, And she did what I think is one of the most incredible new projects in Paris, which is the headquarters, or it's the showroom, I should say, for Citroën on the Champs-Élysées. And God, my French is, I got to get my pronunciation back when I go. But anyway.
Citroën for most of you Southerners is Citron. Yeah. Yeah. That French line of cars they don't sell in the U.S. anymore.
Right. The lemons.
Yes, which I love them. And I have actually a little toy model of one on my desk that I'm looking at.
They were delightful cars, but we could not get them to run the U.S.
No, well, maybe not. Maybe more about the visual.
Maybe it was the ones they sent to us were the defective ones, and they kept the good ones for themselves.
That's a good theory. So this showroom is, it's essentially, these were done, you know, much earlier than where we are now with digital fabrication, but this was done with this sort of incredible fabrication, sort of a facade, jagged facade that sort of zigzags up and down in glass in the front, in this incredible kind of chevron pattern that takes on their chevron logo. And as you walk around it, you walk around these turning turnstiles going up the side, and it's all glass and steel, and just an incredible plan for, I think, way ahead of its time. And there's, you know, it's not the only thing. There's so many things like that in Paris. I think the Ministry of Culture is another great example. That was done with incredibly advanced for its time sort of abstractions of classical art. And they made this, the computer sort of abstracted that, and they did this lace screen on top of the building. The building is actually three connected buildings that had nothing to do with each other. So this genius way of connecting them all was to build this metallic lace metal screen in front of it that connected everything. A really smart plan. And, you know, there's just plans like this all over Paris that people have no idea about. And some really, really great architects. And we're hoping to work with one of those architects on the design for the exhibition, Never Built Paris. There's a firm called Jacob and McFarlane. And they did the project called the Docks of Paris, which is sort of this alien insect that sucks onto the side of the Seine. That's the only way I can put it. but they do some wild things, and we're hoping to work with them on that exhibit. So it's fun. It's fun to get to know these firms that, unbeknownst to most people, are doing some of the most, I think, adventurous architecture in the world.
You've done exhibitions for a number of your books for the Never Built series. How long do those exhibitions last, typically?
The exhibits last anywhere from 2 to 3 months up to about 6 months.
Okay.
And the longest being the Never Built New York at the Queens Museum. You know, it depends on stuff you're getting loaned. Sometimes, frankly, museums, they don't want to do 3 or 4 exhibitions a year, so they'll just do 2. So they have very long runs. And New York was by far the most ambitious project, Never Built New York, so it made sense to have that one up for 6 months. In that show, we not only had a room full of models and original prints that were designed sort of like walking through Manhattan, who our genius designer Christian Wasman developed, but we also had the panorama of the city of New York, which, speaking of mid-century, that's one of the greatest mid-century sort of models ever built. That was built for the World's Fair in 1964, and that was hundreds of thousands of models built to recreate New York City. That's in the Queens Museum. That's sort of the heart of the Queens Museum. And we worked with students at Columbia, GSAP, and they built about 50 new models into the panorama, and they were glowing so they would stand out. So that was a huge undertaking. So to only have that up for a couple of months would have been a shame, I think. So that was worth it.
Now, for people like me who missed that exhibition, is there anything on YouTube or someplace else that we can see pieces of it?
Yeah, probably the best way to see the exhibition itself, one of the better ways, is the New York Times did a daily 360. I don't know if you know about those. It's like virtual.
Sure. Yep.
They did one on the show, so you can sort of walk through the galleries and get a look at that. You can also walk through some of the places in the city, and we did these virtual recreations. We worked with this firm, Shimahara Illustration, and another one called Visual Vocal, and they created these incredible virtual illustrations. We had virtual reality goggles. That was another part of the show. So that was recreated in that daily 360, as well as walkthroughs of the exhibition.
Yeah, you really have to be careful not to bump into walls when you're doing those things.
Yeah, don't do it near a window.
Yeah.
You know.
Don't have a lot of cables on the floor to trip over.
Yeah, exactly. As far as I know, nobody hurt themselves, so it was a success.
Well, Sam, thank you so much for being on the show. I hope to run into you at Donkeys in Camden, maybe soon.
I'm down. Let's go.
Yeah.
I'm totally into it. I thought I knew all my cheesesteak places, so so let's go. You know, a real cheesesteak has to have cheese whiz. I don't know if you know that or not, but
that's, yeah, that's it,
is that a rule?
I think so.
Well, it's debatable. It's debatable, but me and my friends and most people I know in Philly, if you go to like Pat's or Gino's, it's got to be cheese whiz. So you kind of have to be at peace with that if you're going to try the cheesesteak with me.
Well, I understand that Donkey's recipe is very heretical, but that the end result is amazing.
Wow.
So you'll have to keep open mind when you go. I mean, they serve it on a bun. It's a specialty bun to start out with, which is
not a hoagie roll.
Way off of scripture. Yeah.
Not a hoagie roll, hopefully. No. Well, I'm a modernist. I'm open to new things.
All right, Sam, thanks so much for joining us.
Thank you. It's great to talk to you.
Thanks for listening. U.S. Modernist Radio is underwritten by, oh yeah, Angela Roll, your special agent for modernist houses, 919-995-0550.
Visit usmodernist.org to listen to past shows and discover our massive mid-century modernist archives. U.S. Modernist Radio is produced by Soundtracks Recording Studio in Raleigh, North Carolina. Our theme song was performed by George Smart and Robinson Earl. Cindy Stratton, not her real name, researches guest from a secret witness protection program inside Starbucks.
So much for that secret.
U.S. Modernist Radio is a production of Triangle Modernist Archive, a nonprofit educational organization for the documentation, preservation, and promotion of modernist residential design. George and Tom will be back in 2 weeks with another edition of U.S. Modernist Radio.